Python is one of the most popular programming languages in the world today. To start programming with Python, simply download and install the Python interpreter from the official Python website. Then choose your preferred code editor, such as VS Code, and you're ready to begin. Open or create a folder and add a file with the .py extension, usually named main.py. Edit the file, open the command line, and type Python followed by the file name. The Python interpreter will then execute the contents of the file line by line. Next, let's talk about the Python language itself. In Python, everything you see, even a simple number, is an object. You can give that object a label using the equals sign, which is technically called a variable. But thinking of it as a label can actually help you better understand how Python works. You can think of an object as a box on a shelf, and the label as a reference that tells you where that box is. Now, if you assign one label to another, the new label simply points to the same object. Yes, a single object can have multiple labels pointing to it. Anything you do through one of those labels will affect the same underlying object. Python comes with several built-in types of objects like integers, created by typing whole numbers, floating point numbers, created using decimals, booleans, which are either true or false, strings made using double quotes, a special type called none, which represents the absence of a value, just type none. There are also some special types of objects called container types. These are used to store labels that point to other objects. Remember our shelf and box analogy? Container objects are still just boxes, but what's inside them is a bit different. They hold labels, and those labels can lead you to other boxes. Some common container types include lists, created with square brackets. You can access the nth object using square brackets and an index n. Dictionaries, created with curly braces. You can use keys to access specific values. Tuples, which are like lists but immutable, and they use parentheses. For all of these built-in types, you can use print to display their values in the command line, which is super helpful when you're debugging your code. Python comes with a bunch of built-in basic operators, and they mostly work just like the ones you've seen in math. When you use an operator on objects, it usually creates a brand new object. For example, if you add the integer 1 to the integer 2, you get a new integer object 3. If you check whether 1 is greater than 2, you get a new Boolean object false. And if you take the string 1 and multiply it by the integer 3, you get a brand new string triple 1. Just like before, you can assign these new objects to labels using the equals sign, so you can refer to them later in your code. By default, the Python interpreter runs your code from the top of the file, straight down, one line at a time. But Python gives us two powerful tools to break out of that straight line flow: condition and loop. To use conditional branching, you start with if, followed by an object, then a colon, and hit enter to write the code that runs inside the if block. If the object you're checking is a Boolean object with the value true, or it's not a Boolean object but also not none, then the code inside that if block will run. You can also add an optional else block after the if. If the if condition doesn't hold, then the code under else will run instead. Between if and else, you can insert as many elif blocks as you need. Elif just means else if. When the if condition fails, Python will check each elif in order. If one of them is true, it runs that block and skips the rest. To create a loop, use while, followed by an object, then a colon, and a new indented block. The rule for while is the same as for if. As long as the object is Boolean type and value true, the code inside the loop runs. After each run, Python checks the condition again. If it's still true, it loops again. Once the condition is false, the loop stops. Python also gives you two handy tools to control your loop. Use continue if you want to skip the rest of the current loop and jump straight to the next round. Use break if you want to exit the loop entirely, right then and there. With just these three tools, sequential flow, conditions, and loops, you can build some pretty complex programs. For example, here's a simple bit of code that calculates the sum of all the elements in a list called array. If you ever find yourself writing a piece of code that's useful and might be reused later, for example, that list summing code I just showed you, you can bundle it up using the def keyword, followed by a function name and parentheses. This creates a special kind of object called a function object, and the function name becomes its label. Anywhere else in your code, you can call this function by writing its name with parentheses, and Python will run the code inside. You can also define some labels inside the parentheses, technically called parameters. When you call the function, you can pass in objects using the equals sign to bind values to those labels. That way, the function can use whatever values you provide, making it flexible and reusable. So now, our sum function could add up any list, not just list array. Also, during a function's execution, it might create new objects. For instance, our sum function will produce an integer object that holds the total. If you want to use that result outside the function, you can use the return statement. That tells Python to hand back a reference to that object, and you can assign it to a label outside the function to use however you like. This is a great way to package up useful functionality, for example, a simple, reusable way to calculate the sum of any list. And just so you know, even if you don't use return in a function, or if you write return with nothing after it, Python will automatically return the none object. Python comes with a bunch of built-in functions. We've already seen print, which shows you information about objects. There's also len, which gives you the length of a list. Actually, we used it in the sum function above to get the length of array. These built-in tools can save you a lot of time and make your code cleaner. In Python, besides using built-in object types, you can also define your own types using the class keyword. Here's a basic template for creating a custom object. Inside the class, there's a special function called init. This gets called automatically when you create a new object. Any variables you define using self.insideinit are called member variables. Functions defined inside a class are called member functions. For example, you could use this template to create an object called counter. In it, n could represent the current count, and you might have two functions, increase and decrease, to adjust that count. To create a custom object defined by a class, technically called an instance of the class, just write the class name followed by parentheses. To access member variables or functions, use the dot operator, like c.n or c.increase. You may have noticed that we didn't specify a value for the self parameter when calling increase. That's because it is automatically bound to the object that calls it by Python, in this case, c, so there's no need to specify it manually. This means that if a class method has multiple parameters, you only need to pass arguments starting from the second one. And importantly, each object keeps its own data and functions, so multiple objects won't interfere with each other. Now, one part that might trip you up at first is the self keyword. At its core, self is just a label that points to the instance of the class itself. So for C1, self refers to C1. For C2, it refers to C2. That means when you use self.inside a class, you're accessing or modifying this object's own variables or calling its own functions. And finally, remember? Everything in Python is an object, even things like numbers and strings. You got it? Yes. They also have member variables and functions. For instance, the string method upper returns an uppercase version of the string. The int method to bytes returns a bytes object representing the integer. Up until now, we've been writing all our code in a single file. But as your program grows and you add more and more functions, that file can quickly become hard to manage. That's when it makes sense to split your code into multiple files. For example, you can move some of your variables and functions into another file called utils.py, placed in the same folder as main.py. Now, utils.py becomes a module. If you want to use a function from it in main.py, you can simply import it using the from import syntax. And yes, modules can also import other modules, as long as they're in the same folder or Python knows where to find them. While modules help manage growing programs to some extent, they have to live in the same directory as your main program. But as your project keeps getting bigger, things can still get complicated. That's why Python offers the concept of packages, which let you organize modules in a hierarchical way. To create a package, all you need to do is make a folder, put some modules inside it, and add an empty init.py file. This file basically tells Python, hey, this folder is a package. Usually, init.py doesn't need to have any actual content, it's mainly a marker. You can also create packages inside packages, building a nested hierarchical structure for your code. When you want to import a module from a package, you just use from import and follow the package's folder structure step by step. One important thing, inside a package, when modules import each other, you have to use relative imports. You can't just write the module name like before. For example, from .import means import from this folder, while from double.import means import from the parent folder. This package system makes it easier to organize and reuse code, and it's become the foundation of Python's whole ecosystem. And to top it off, Python comes with a handy tool called pip. Pip lets you download and install packages other people have written, and it's installed automatically with Python. Using pip is super simple. You just type pip install package name in the command line, and then you can use that package in your project right away. All right, that's pretty much everything you need to know to get started with Python. Honestly, this video isn't the easiest to digest because there's a lot of information packed in for beginners. But once you truly understand everything we've covered, you'll have a solid mental model of Python programming that'll let you explore the Python world with confidence and freedom. Thanks for watching. I'm Mark. See you next time.